one. Proverbs 31, 10 through 31. You know, the world holds up all sorts of images as to what you and I are supposed to be. The world holds up all sorts of what you might call false examples of the kind of person that you and I are supposed to be. And the overriding philosophy of the world today is really that you live any way that you want to live. We are seeing that right now in the gay marriage issue. We're now 11 states have awarded gay people, I guess you might say, the what they call the right to marry. And they've given a kind of legal approval to this philosophy that says that you can live any way that you want to live, and it's okay. But the Word of God gives us a different picture. The Word of God tells us quite explicitly how we are supposed to live. And in Proverbs chapter 31, verses 10 through 31, what we have in front of us is a pattern. The pattern here, as it's specifically stated, is supposed to apply to women. But you know what? Really, as we take a look at this pattern and the parts of the pattern, we're going to see that really this passage applies to both men and women. It applies to everybody. The principles that are contained here apply to each and every person. And so while the theme of this passage, if you want to be specific about it, is be the woman that God wants you to be, I think we can apply that also more broadly just to say, be the person that God wants you to be. Be the man or the woman that God wants you to be. Let's go before God in prayer right now and ask Him to speak to us. Heavenly Father, we need to hear from You right now. Lord God, we need You to speak to us. We need You to speak to our hearts, because the law of the world, Lord God, gives us all sorts of other messages and all sorts of other examples of how we're supposed to live our lives. We need to hear from You, Lord God, as to a godly example, a godly pattern as to how we're supposed to live our lives. Lord God, we pray right now that You would make each and every person here into the person of God that You want them to be, O God. Lord, we pray once again, if there be any backsliders in our midst, people, Lord God, who at one time had professed faith in You, but have not been living according to how You want them to live, Lord Jesus, we pray that You would bring them all back to You today. And Lord God, if there's someone here who has never put their faith and trust in You, we ask, Lord God, that today would be the day that they do just that. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Beginning in the 10th verse, it says this: an excellent wife, who can find? For her worth is far above jewels. The heart of her husband trusts in her, and he will have no lack of gain. She does him good and not evil all the days of her life. She looks for wool and flax, and works with her hands in delight. She is like merchant ships She brings her food from afar. She rises also while it is still night and gives food to her household and portions to her maidens. She considers a field and buys it. From her earnings, she plants a vineyard. She girds herself with strength and makes her arms strong. She senses that her gain is good, and her lamp does not go out at night. She stretches out her hands to the distaff, and her hands grasp the spindle. She extends her hands to the poor, and she stretches out her hands to the needy. She is not afraid of the snow for her household, for all her household are clothed with scarlet. She makes coverings for herself. She is clothed in fine linen and purple. Her husband is known in the gates when he sits among the elders of the land. She makes linen garments and sells them and supplies belts to the tradesmen. Strength and dignity are her clothing, and she smiles at the future. She opens her mouth in wisdom, and the teaching of kindness is on her tongue. She looks well to the ways of her household and does not eat the bread of idleness. Her children rise up and bless her. Her husband also, and he praises her, saying, "Many daughters have done nobly, but you excel them all." Charm is deceitful, and beauty is vain, but a woman who fears the Lord, she shall be praised. Give her the product of her hands, and let her works praise her in the gates. And may God add a blessing to the reading of his word for his name's sake. The world, as we said, holds up all sorts of other patterns that are different from the word of God. Other patterns in which they try to tell us what we're supposed to be like. Being that it's Mother's Day, and being that this text specifically mentions the godly woman, let me just tell you about what the world's image of a woman is supposed to be. You look at the media, you look at the advertisements that you see on television or on the internet and so on and so forth, and you know what you see most of the time? Women that look a certain way. Right? And that they dress a certain way. They have a certain physical appearance about them. They have what the world deems as beauty. But you will notice, according to this passage, what the world recognizes as beautiful and what God recognizes as beautiful are two completely different facts. What the world views as attractive, what the world views as gorgeous, is one thing, and what God says is attractive and what God says is gorgeous is a completely different thing. You may notice, as we read this passage here, you know, there was no description of this woman's physical appearance. Nothing. Nothing is said of her body. Nothing is said. We don't know if she might be tall and slim. We don't know. She might be short and fat. We don't know. She might be whatever, she might be heavyset, she might be skinny, whatever it is, we know nothing of this woman's physical appearance because God does not emphasize the physical. The Word of God tells us that man looks at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks in on the heart. And what we have here is an inside view of the heart of this godly woman. And as we take a look at this pattern of a godly woman, we're going to see 10 characteristics about her. And like we said, even though the pattern here specifically mentions woman, really applies to both men and women as well. Let me give you, though, just a little bit of background information before we get into those 10 principles of what it takes to be the person that God wants us to be. The words here come from a person identified in verse 1 as King Lemuel. And it says here, the oracle which his mother taught him. Let me tell you something. He is a godly woman. And you know what she's doing? She's sitting down with her child. She's sitting down with her son. And you know what? She is taking responsibility for her child's education. Too many times today, we think it is the school's responsibility to educate our children. Let me tell you something, it is not the school's primary responsibility to educate our children. You know whose responsibility that is? That's the parents' responsibility. It is your responsibility as a man or as a woman. You know what? If you had small children, it's your responsibility to educate them. And the school is just one tool that you can use for that purpose. Here we have this mother, and she recognizes that it is her responsibility, not somebody else's, not the school, not this one, not that one, not this other person. She's taking responsibility for her children, and we need more mothers and fathers like that today who will stand up and say, you know what, it's my responsibility to teach my children. You know what happens? If this is just for those who might be thinking of becoming parents in the future. You know what happens? When you hand your children off to the school, you give the school the primary responsibility for their education, you know what happens? You then give the right over to the school to educate your child, not as you want them to be educated, but as they want them to be educated. And you know what? That's how we got all this evolution being taught in the schools and all this stuff about Heather has two mommies and Greg has two daddies and so on. We got all that foolishness taught in the schools because I think a lot of responsibility rests upon us as Christians. We just turned it over to the schools. We just said, schools, you educate our children. No, that's not it's our primary responsibility to educate our children. And you know what? That education is not only in the religious or biblical sphere. That education pertains to whatever subject you can think of. It's our responsibility. It's our responsibility to make sure our kids learn mathematics and English and science and whatever from a godly point of view. That's what this woman did. She took responsibility for her son's education, and she is so concerned about it that she's struggling to find the right words, I should say, that she should use to educate her child. So you know what she says to her son is something that's going to be very very serious and something that we better pay attention to. Because she says in verse 2, "What, O my son, and what, O son of my womb, and what, O son of my bowels?" She's saying here, you know what? You came out of my body. You're the son of my womb. Therefore, it's my responsibility to educate you, not somebody else's. And she said, when you were born, I made vows. Many of us, when we had children, what did we do? We took them to the church and we dedicated them to the Lord. Right? And we dedicated them and we dedicated ourselves to the Lord. And we said, we're going to raise up our child, or we're going to raise up our children in the way that the Lord wants us to educate and raise them up. And that's what this woman said. She said, when you were born, I made vows. And I'm going to fulfill those vows by educating you and raising you up to be the man that God wants you to be. I'm not going to shift you off to the world for the world to raise you up as the world wants you to be. I'm going to take responsibility. I made vows, and I'm going to fulfill those vows to train you up and educate you in the things of God. The first thing that she warns him against is getting involved with loose women. She does that in verse 3. And then, verses 4 through 7, she advises her son, she urges him not to get involved in alcohol. And then verses 8 and 9, she urges her son to speak up for justice and to speak up for those who cannot defend themselves. You will notice, though, she spends one verse speaking about the loose woman. She spends about 3 or 4 verses speaking about alcohol and drunkenness. She spends 2 verses on justice, but she spends 22 verses on teaching him how to find the right woman. And so you know what? Let me tell you something. This passage applies just as much to us men as it does to the women. And if you're out there and you've never been married and you're looking for a wife, this is the kind of woman that you need to be looking for. You need to be looking for a woman who has set her heart for the Lord, who loves the Lord Jesus Christ and is walking in obedience to him and is living a Christian life that produces fruit. That's the kind of woman that you need to marry. The Bible specifically warns us about being unequally yoked with unbelievers. And yet, you know what happens? Too many times, even us as Christians, we're not concerned about our own welfare. We're not concerned about our own marriages. And you know what we do? We go ahead and marry whoever we feel like, not even wondering if that person, if that man, or if that woman knows Christ as their Savior and loves the Lord. And we become very, very reckless with that. And you know what? That's why divorce is so high, even among Christians. Because we do not pay serious heed to what the Word of God says about the type of person that we are supposed to marry. But we see here, coming down into the 10th verse, that God wants us to be the kind of person that he has designed us to be. We see here in verse 10, the first thing, we're going to see 10 total things about this woman, but the first thing that we see in verse 10 is that she is described as an excellent wife. In other words, she's a noble woman. Not noble in terms of being a part of royalty, but in terms of her character, she's noble. I like the way it's worded in the King James Version. It calls her a virtuous woman. This word that's translated virtuous here can also be translated as capable, can also be translated as skillful. can be translated as able. It can also be translated as strong. She's a strong woman, but the reference here is not to physical strength, but rather it is to spiritual strength. It is to strength of character. As a matter of fact, in the book of Exodus, the 18th chapter, and in the 21st verse, the same word is used, but in a different context. There, you may recall this, when Moses was leading the children of Israel, he had a congregation of about 1.5 million people. And for many years, Moses was the only judge in the land. So whenever there was a court case, a criminal case, a family dispute, or what have you, all the court cases, remember, went to Moses. Moses' father-in-law saw this and said, Moses, you keep doing this, this is going to kill you. So you know what he says to Moses in chapter 18, verse 21 of the book of Exodus? He says to Moses, find yourself able men, men who fear God, men who love truth, and men who hate bribery, and set them as judges over the people. Now here's the interesting thing. That word there that's translated able, when it says find able men, is the same word that's translated excellent or virtuous here. You know what that means? That men can be virtuous and should be virtuous just like women should be virtuous. And it's telling us that what this means right here is that whether we're a man or a woman, we are to demonstrate strength of character. That's the first principle that was demonstrated in this woman's life. She was a woman of spiritual strength, a woman of character. But there's more about her. It says going on in the 10th verse about her, who can find such a woman? For her worth is far above jewels. So you know what this tells us? This is a rare kind of woman. This is an exceptional and rare kind of woman. Perhaps you've read the story of Queen Jezebel. You remember her from the Old Testament? Just how wicked she was and how she prompted her husband to kill a guy and how she was greedy for power and she lusted for control. You know what? There are more people in this world, many more people in this world, who are like Jezebel than who are like the woman that's described here. The woman that's described here is a rare kind of woman. And you know what? If you're a man and you've never been married and you're looking for a wife, that's the kind of woman that you want. You don't want a Jezebel. A Jezebel will bring you down. She brought her husband down. She didn't lift her husband up. She didn't exalt her husband or make him a better person. She made him a worse person. You want a woman. You need a woman who's going to lift you up. And the same thing, you know what, with the ladies today. The ladies today, when they're looking for a husband, they need a husband who will lift them up, who will make them into better people, who will make them spiritually stronger, who will help them to grow in Christ. Not somebody who's going to tear them down. And let me tell you something, those kinds of people are hard to find today. So you know what? As we're all here, listen to this. You got to resolve to be one of those rare kind of people yourself. You commit yourself today. You say, okay, Lord, no matter how many Jezebel-like people we've got out there in the world, I'm going to follow you, Lord Jesus. And I'm going to live the way that you want me to live. No matter how rare and how exceptional it may be, no matter how much pressure the world may put on you to try to make you like it and what the world wants you to be, you say, you know what? No way. I'm not going to do that. As God gives me strength, as God gives me grace, as God gives me the power, I'm going to be the man or woman that God wants me to be, no matter how rare it may seem to be. This third thing that you're going to see about this woman, and this is important, in verses 10 through 12 and in verse 23, she makes her husband a better man. Let me tell you something. Any spouse who truly loves their spouse is going to seek to do things and to live a way that makes that other person a better person. You put their welfare ahead of your own. And that's what this woman does here. And you know what? We've got too many instances in this world today where folks get married, and instead of them putting the welfare, let's say if it's a man, him putting the welfare of his wife ahead of himself, or if it's a wife, instead of her putting the welfare of her husband ahead of herself, too many times they're looking for their own welfare. And they're looking for their own benefit. They're getting married not to seek to improve or help somebody else, but they're getting married to seek what they can get out of that marriage. Let me tell you something. You go into a marriage like that, and your marriage will end up in disaster. If you go into a marriage for the purposes of selfish gain, that's a recipe for divorce court. Get ready, because that's where you're going. But this woman here, she's looking out for the welfare of her husband. Look at what it says in verse 11. The heart of her husband trusts in her. The husband, you see, he's got complete trust in this woman. He's got complete confidence in her. He knows her character already, that she's a godly woman, that she's a woman who loves the Lord Jesus Christ. And so, you know what? He's got no worries, because she has put her husband above herself. As a matter of fact, it goes on to say in verse 12, look at this, she does him good and not evil all the days of her life. Look at verse 23, too. Her husband is known among the gates when he sits among the elders of the land. And if you look at this whole context, you see that the reason why that her husband is known in the gates, why he's respected and admired among the people, is because of her. Because she has lifted him up, and she has sought out his benefit and his welfare ahead of her own. So you know what ends up happening? Her husband looks real good in front of other people. And I can testify that, you know what? That's the kind of wife that I have in Israel. I would not be the man that I am today without my precious wife. She has made me a better man. You know why? Because she has put my interests and my welfare ahead of her own. That's the way wives need to be. That's the way husbands need to be also. And so we see the first thing is that she's a woman of strength of character. The second thing that we see is that she's a rare kind of woman. The third thing that we see is that she puts her husband ahead of herself and makes him a better man because of that. But we see more things. Fourthly, we see, look at this, she's also a very diligent, hard-working, and industrious kind of woman. Look at verse 13. She looks for wool and flax and works with her hands in delight. She's happy to be working. She's not regretting it. She's not poo-pooing herself. She's not saying, oh, I have so much work to do and woe is me and so on and so forth. She loves doing the work that God has for her to do. And she does it with delight. She does it with happiness. Look at verse 15. It says, she rises while it is still night. This woman gets up early.